So for those of you who are here for the first time, the Virtual Futures Conference occurred at the University of Warwick during the mid-90s. And to quote its co-founder, it arose at a tipping point of the technologization of first world cultures. Whilst it was often portrayed as a techno-positivist festival of accelerationism towards a post-human future, the Glastonbury of cyberculture, as The Guardian put it, its actual aim hidden behind the brush steel and silicon, the jargon and the designer drugs, the charismatic prophets and the techno parties, was much more sober and much more urgent. What VF did was cast a critical eye over the phenomenal changes in how humans and perhaps non-humans engage with emerging scientific and technological development. So this Salon series, and we're hoping it's going to be a series, completes the conference's aim to bury the 20th century and begin work on the 21st. So let's begin. We are here tonight to talk about world building. Of course, you've been told that we're here to talk about virtual reality. But why waste an evening on a term that's already been degraded into a synonym for the artificial or for simulation? Today's antonym for reality has been commandeered by commercial entities. Perhaps it's time to accept that the term virtual reality is fast becoming a useless conceptual tool. But world building. Now, world building is something that the virtual future stage is all too familiar with, especially over our last 20-year history. Yes, we are no stranger to world builders. From the Australian feminist arts group VNS Matrix, who in 1991 introduced us to radically transgressive interactive computer games for non-specific genders, to the digital artificial life simulations that populated the virtual landscape of Jane Prophet and Dr. Gordon Selly's technosphere in 1995. But back then, audiences had a grave problem with dealing with this promise of cyberspace. But today, well, today we fetishize these devices and experiences that drive us away from the actual world. Bring on the new topographical spaces of infinite possibility. We are now more willing to embrace the digitization and its binary form of ones and zeros. Might that repetitive logic finally erode the traditional distinction between actual reality and its virtual counterpart? Yes, we've seen these worlds before, and today the resolution has vastly improved, as you'll be able to see downstairs, but this only ensures that we continue to fail to perceive the machinery of the virtual. It seems almost fitting that the virtual was once commonly used as a term to refer to nearly or almost. So, in our desire for these high-resolution realities, what has become the key indicator of the efficacy of simulation? Well, immersion. Developers are preoccupied with fooling your brain into feeling like you're actually there. Where do you want to go today? A 1994 marketing slogan turned 20-year raison d'etre for these world builders. But what if where you want to go is somewhere that's never been fully actualized? What if where you might want to go is born of mathematical topographies, morphogenic forms, and genetic algorithms? What is the effect of these sorts of experiences on our state of consciousness? Psychedelics has emerged as the best descriptor for these external, technologically mediated simulations that perhaps evoke out-of-body experiences and trips. Although the field has been developing for the last 50 years, the recent proliferation of commercial VR devices has now driven new attempts to collide the psychedelic and consciousness culture of the late 60s with the computer cultures of the 80s and the 90s. The outcome? Well, the entertainment industry has given us representations of retro aesthetic with new names but frighteningly familiar forms. I think we've seen this shit before. Although New Millennia Cyberdelics promises an entirely new type of experience, how far can we really go in creating non-ordinary states of consciousness? How can the sensorimotory data that we receive from the outside world affect our brain? Will the VR headset ever become the LSD of the new millennium? And so, to answer some of these questions, or perhaps none of these questions, are our esteemed panel. Join me as we attempt to find the others. And I want to kick off with you, Carl. So Carl Smith is Director of Learning Technology and Research at Ravensbourne. And it's this thing about virtual reality. As you see virtual reality, it's not purely about this screen-based culture. You talk more about hybrid realities. In other words, technologies that contribute to what I think you call context engineering. And could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. Can we get the slides up?
Mr. Everyone.
So, people can turn. If you can go to the first one. That's it. So yeah, a really big problem with VR is that it just focuses on the visual. And I think if we're just focusing on one sense, then we're going to lead to a diminished reality rather than an augmented reality. Next slide. This is a game that's just come out called Bloodsport, which effectively means that you're linking yourself up to a drip whilst you're in the Oculus. And every time you get shot in the game, it takes real blood out of your body. The last man standing wins, the last man who hasn't fainted. And then the blood gets donated to the blood bank. So full on context engineering, everyone's happy. I've actually just come out of some legal trials, got paid to do LSD by the government in hospital, administered by nurses. And they were looking at creative problem solving. And the day before we did the LSD, we actually did holotropic breath work. And I was really fascinated, and actually that was more profound than the LSD. Next slide. So I'm really interested in out-of-body experiences and these entheogenic technologies and ways that we can break out of the body, because I believe there's a lot to be learned when we're no longer in the body. Next slide. We just got nearly 3 million euros from the Horizon 2020 program to create a new form of media called wearable experience. And in simple terms, what we're actually trying to do is, if you imagine a surgeon doing surgery, we can map the surgery in real time, make a 3D model on the fly of it, and then map the surgeon, map his head movement, his eye movement, his finger movement, his hand movement. And then a novice surgeon wearing gloves and smart glasses can actually wear his experience and embody him. Next slide. I'm really interested in looking back to ancient technologies, such as the memory palaces, where a Greek orator would never have written his 7-hour speech down, but he'd have a piece of virtual architecture in his head that he'd basically map his 7-hour speech to this virtual architecture and just remember the path through the structure. So this is like a modern version of augmented reality. Next slide. So I've basically done a lot of 3D modeling. I did about 7 years of 3D modeling, and it had tremendously weird effects on my brain, where this was a building that I spent 6 months building. And actually, it sort of burnt into my third eye as a cognitive structure. And I can remember every single part of the structure. And so I'm mapping my PhD into this 3D space in order to actually get that data to actually start to relate to itself in very different ways than it would do on flat 2D paper. Next slide. So this is context engineering, when we start to really hack into things like the visual system. We've got a 360 headset here, where we're squashing a 360 input into 180 degrees. And it only takes your brain 15 minutes to adjust to seeing in 360 with no nausea. And what does it mean if we all can see in 360? Next slide. Or this in Japan. I spent a couple of months in Japan last year looking in the cyber labs in Tokyo and Keio universities. And they're already doing this context engineering where you're wearing glasses whilst you eat. It increases the size of your food and tricks your brain into thinking you're eating more than you actually are. Next slide. Or this, the ISEC device, where arms and fingers become eye muscles, and you're able to move your eyes around to create impossible human biological perspectives. Next slide. Or this, an artist in China, And this is exactly the idea of context engineering, reimagining what already exists by using perspective to shape reality instead of changing reality itself. Next slide. Or this, where we can actually start to augment the spaces between taste and smell, re-engineering these two kinds of space. Where you're actually eating here, it releases different aromas to create a whole new range of experience. Next slide. Or this bionic hearing from Doppler Labs, where these earbuds capture sounds as it enters your ears and actually enables you to filter out certain kinds of sound, like your partner snoring or a baby crying. So you can context engineer the sound environment in real time. Next slide. Or this, a new headphones called Nirvana, which actually interferes with the vagus nerve and allows you to experience sound in a very different way. So you actually, it changes your state of the state of your brain, and you can actually feel the sound. Next slide. And as I mentioned about out of body, now we can use the Oculus. We've just linked the Oculus up to two cameras, put the cameras behind you, and you're looking at this person. It's you, and you're instantly out of body. Very easy to hack into, an easy hack. So what does it mean? Next slide. Olaf Blanc has actually found a part of the brain. If you actually give a small electrical signal to the right angular gyrus, you create an out-of-body experience automatically, and the materialists all go wild thinking this is the answer. Next slide. Well, this is where we actually swap bodies, where two people are actually swapping the inputs on their Oculus and actually touching themselves at specific spots, telling their partner where they're touching themselves. If they're both doing it in sync, they swap bodies. Next slide. Good friend of mine, Mark Farid, he's going to wear the Oculus Rift for 28 days. He's got 1.2 million from Red Bull to do the experiment. He's going to look through somebody else's eyes and listen to their life and not have any access to his own senses. He's even going to wear it in the shower and while he sleeps. I think the world record's 4 days, so no one knows what's going to happen to him. Next slide. Or this, where we actually go into the third view and actually... Professor Inami, I was working with in Japan, he strapped a camera on his back to see what he looked like when he was going skiing, to see his technique from outside his body. 20 years ago he did that. Next slide. This is their tele-existence system in Japan. And this, you put the gloves on and the eyewear, and you enter a robot body. You look to your right and you're actually sitting next to yourself. Next slide. When Professor Inami actually tried this on, it said it changed his career instantly. He immediately stopped doing what he's doing and went into VR. Next slide. This is just me in the lab. Next slide. Next slide. Or passenger's helmet. This idea that actually now we can actually use transcranial stimulation whilst we sleep to reliably create lucid dreams. What does it mean when lucid dreams becomes a new space where we can potentially work? Next slide. Galantamine is an actual pill that we can take to, again, reliably create lucid dreaming. Next slide. So just to finish off, this idea that we've got these problems in virtual spaces like nausea, they found out if you put a virtual nose in the virtual space, you no longer have nausea. Next slide. Or this, we don't know some of the effects of technologies until we do longitudinal studies. Tetris, the video game, actually fixed the lazy eye problem. And the last time I gave this slide in a talk, somebody said, well, is that a persistent effect? That's my talk. Thank you.
Yeah. So, Carl, the one was two questions, really. One, does he have to drink Red Bull for the full 28 days? Because if anything induces lucid dreaming in me, it's drinking Red Bull for 28 days straight. But secondly, the thing that you were showing us with all of those slides is it's not about the technology that's central, it's about the human that's central. And why is it that the human, or all of these artists, designers, technologists, are working with the materiality of the senses before they're working with the devices, if that makes sense?
Well, I think that we've all been subjected to these corporate solutions that are very technocentric, and we're not looking at the human need, and I think a lot of artists come at it from a human perspective. So it's that point that they're trying to make with these solutions.
Well, one of those artists that might be coming from it from a human perspective is Michael, whose new Jerusalem piece you're able to view downstairs in the basement. And Michael, we spoke on the phone briefly, but your training is originally fine arts, and that's guided your work in virtual reality. Am I right in saying?
Well, my formal training is in science and technology, but then I decided to not pursue that career, much to the disgust of my family, and sort of become a visual artist. My training in fine art and contemporary art was basically I used to skip school and go to the Smithsonian all the time. But certainly, that's always been one part of my life. I brought just a few slides, if you go to the first one.
Just click next, Matthew.
This is the other half of my inspiration. In this, you might recognize some of these things, everything from Wii to Xbox, Rock Band to Destiny. I'm an avid game player. Gaming has always been part of my lifestyle. I consider myself sort of a first generation digital person insofar as that when I was a young teenager, I built my first computers because parts in the sort of 286 days were kind of coming on the market. For me, virtual reality in the sort of contemporary modern sense is not the very immersive graphical experiences you see today, but it's the first generation of bulletin boards and multi-user MUDs, multi-user dungeons that were text only. Because virtual space is all about sort of, it starts with the mind. It's about projecting yourself into another space. And in our conversation, Luke, if we could go to the next slide. When we were talking about sort of this panel, Lewis, can you go to the next slide? Thanks. These are some early projects that I did in Second Life. One of the things that kind of I remember from our conversation, we were talking about, is this going to be, have we reached the time where sort of virtual reality, all this stuff is really going to come into being? And for me, I'm still a little bit skeptical. I'm skeptical because I've been in this area for basically since it came into being, all the way from text only. And you reach these points of critical mass, and then nothing happens. So a great example of that was Second Life. So myself and colleagues of mine, we worked in Second Life really from day one. And we did really interesting creative research projects. I mean, these here are some projects that I did, both, up top you see the in-world views of those projects, sort of in the shared virtual environments of Second Life, and then sort of the lower set are the physical manifestations of it. So it was this interesting sort of space where you could just do whatever, you could work within a system, you could blend the virtual and the physical, you could blend the analog and the digital, sort of combining these different realities. It was a really exciting time. But on sort of a mainstream level, it fell flat. And why did it fall flat? Well, we can talk about things in terms of commerce, in terms of accessibility, in terms of usability. But we were at a critical mass with virtual reality then. And then there was a regression. So now we're in a time, if we go to the final slide. So yes, I mean, today we're going to experience a lot of things on Oculus, on gear, on cardboard. And yes, we're at another point of critical mass, but I just wanted to bring this up. On the left-hand side are some pictures from quite some time ago. The first, the top left, that's a Roman wall painting. So if we talk about virtual reality and virtuality, we think of concepts like illusion and immersion. These are not new concepts, okay? Roman wall painting, using the technology of their time, it was about building these communal spaces, these architectural spaces where you would immerse yourself in with other people and project the consciousness into other places. You know, there are some academics like one of the fathers of VR, Howard Rheingold, who sort of, he would argue, and I agree with him, that even our first forms of art in communal spaces, like the cave paintings in Lesseau, that's a virtual reality for the time. It's a scenographic communal projection space. So technology has always been a part and parcel. So whereas you have Roman wall painting at the top, project of mine on the right-hand side top is using sort of like immersive projection technologies. Same sort of thing, different technologies, but it is the same sort of principle. Or down where we, the lower right-hand corner, it's a full dome. So mobile planetariums, full dome projection, 360-degree environments, all of this stuff, communal, real time. In this day and age, with things like Oculus, with things like, gear, if you ask me, what is going to make the difference? And I'll tell you, really, from my experience, it's going to be the content. It's going to be the experience. Because we all through the sort of this course, the last 20 years, where these things have kind of been coming into being slowly and in steps, all the false starts from critical mass have always sort of happened because of lack of content. Because at the end of the day, if, you know, technology, well, you know, it's interesting. The first time, past that, people want to say, well, why? You know, what actually can it bring to me that I don't get to experience in the analog world? So it's something that is not, you know, some of my colleagues in digital humanities talk about the digital photocopier. I'm not interested in taking an analog experience and replicating it, making it cheaper or more accessible or what have you. I'm interested in a born digital experience that is inherently different, that offers different possibilities to what we have now. That's what's exciting, and that's what's going to actually draw people back in. So if we can do that with these new technologies, if we can do that with the headsets we'll be seeing here, you know, later tonight, then yes, I think the critical mass will actually, you know, go on and be sustainable. If not, it'll be like the old sort of technologies that came and then just died because the content wasn't there, the experiences weren't there. So that's kind of my take.
Well,
on
that
it.
Does feel like when they have the representations where they capture 360 and they just represent back, what's the point?
Absolutely. You know, it was a weird thing. I was one of the speakers on the research strand at this year's VR UK conference. It was a several-day conference that was hosted at Ravensbourne this year. And the talk selection from the research side, it was really exciting. That was, for me, one of the highlights. One of the great disappointments was actually the demo floor, which I remember this, you know, I walk in there with some colleagues, and the first thing I come across is, you know, it's the HTC Vive, and they're using it to demo a drive through the sort of the windy sort of coastal path on Monaco. And I just think, really? I mean, what the fuck? If I want to go, and you know, I'll go to my friends in the States, I will we'll get in their convertible and we'll actually go for a drive. You know, why on earth would I want to do that? Or another sort of demo there was like, okay, a recording of a concert, and you know, it's putting the cameras, putting you there in the center of the mosh pit, and it's like, I'm going to go to DC, I'm going to go to the 930 Club, and I'm actually going to feel the people and actually listen to the live performance and be there with the sweat. You know, I am just, I mean, what? I mean, you know, and that was the whole sort of floor. It was things like that, by and large, and it was so disappointing. And I thought to myself, it's like, for all the critical mass we've built up, if this is what you're going to offer the public, it will be interesting for a few months, and then it's gone. Because why would you do it?
This is why it feels like some of the stuff that's happening in the basement and some of your work, that world-building piece is key.
Absolutely.
Because you can build something that hasn't existed already. And
yes.
It feels like right now the live demos are driving through representations of things where you're on a helicopter suddenly in the middle of New York. And I know that, Toby, some of the stuff that you're doing with the National Theatre, you have built a world. You built the world of Wonderland. And even though you were using, and again, it's another demo that you can watch downstairs, and even though you were using virtual reality, the real technology that you were using with Wonder.Land was storytelling.
Yeah, completely. And that's the reason that we're interested in this area, is just what it actually means for storytelling. We could be interested from a tech perspective, but again, like that's not where our remit is. Our strength is in telling stories. And also giving people experiences that are different to those that they can ordinarily experience, which is what you were talking about.
Why storytelling was so important to the creation of that experience for the National Theatre?
Yeah, so, well, there was storytelling, and there was also, like, one of the things that we say about what we're doing at the theatre is that we can put you in the shoes of another person, so we can allow you to experience something that you couldn't ordinarily experience. And when we knew what Wonderland was going to be, which it would just take a minute to explain the production, if that's okay. So we've got a musical on at the National at the moment called Wonder.Land, and it's a Damon Albarn musical version of Alice in Wonderland, where Alice is actually this kind of Barbie-esque, perfectly formed avatar, and Ali, of this girl called Ali, who's a high school teenager. And she's got problems at home, problems at school, etc. And the rabbit hole is actually the internet. And so what happens is her going into Wonderland is her going into this Wonderland space through her phone. And when we knew that's what that it was going to be, people said, oh, you should, let's make a game. And I was like, well, we're not game developers. We've got no time. We've got no money. The idea that we can make a really good game is not on our side. And actually, that's not an innovative thing to do. It's not the right thing for us to do. You know, bearing in mind, we want to put people in places they couldn't ordinarily be. I want to use kind of VR and allow people to fall down the rabbit hole and be small as a mouse, big as a house, all that kind of stuff. And that really got the attention of our directors. They were like, yes, this is new technology and we should be using it for that, not just to allow people to experience tech. So what we did with Wonderland is we took the designs from the show and then from 59 Productions, who are the design agency on the show, and then we worked with another agency, Play Nicely, who worked in Unity to make it into kind of what we call the music video. And the kind of response from that was actually, that was really good because we weren't actually trying to give people a narrative at that point or give them a game mechanic. It was just purely ephemeral that they would encounter it. The next step that we're now going on to is specifically looking at 360 film and maybe a blend between the two for new forms of storytelling. So we're going to be commissioning new writing. So the thing you were talking about before is just throwing a 360. You know, people are coming to us and saying, you know, are you going to put NT Live, which is our live to cinema broadcast, are you going to do that in 360? And actually, the answer to that is no, because you don't just put a 360 camera on stage, because then you're seeing it in a way that was never intended. When it's on stage, this is the stage, and you're all supposed to see it over there. It doesn't make sense if you come and see it up here, because you get a completely incorrect experience.
Well, is the visual language of storytelling changing specifically for VR? Are you noticing the people you're bringing in to work on that project? Are they changing the ways in which they're staging pieces, for example? Are you seeing that already?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I mean, it's very, very early days. And I think, you know, we are at the kind of, you know, we're still at the 9mm film kind of phase of VR at the moment. So we're right at the very beginning. And it's only natural that the tech, which is essential at this part, is ahead of the content. Well, that will change over a period of time. Like the content will become the kind of the most important thing. But what we're finding and hearing in a lot of places is the importance of theater to storytelling in VR. So we were at Sundance recently. The piece that downstairs was selected for Sundance. And I was listening to a panel session with someone from Lucasfilm, Facebook, Oculus, and they were talking about the importance of immersive theater and asking, you know, the audience, have they heard of this company, theater company called Punch Drunk? And it's like, well, actually we've been working with them for 10 years kind of thing. But it was great to see that kind of development side of the industry were latching on to theater. And we ran workshops earlier this year with kind of theater practitioners. So we had 15 writers, directors, designers looking at the kind of dramaturgical potential for VR. And it was just incredible. Like I've been in conversations with traditional filmmakers, say, who might be dragged kicking and screaming into this idea of 360 film and virtual reality because they feel like they've lost control. But the theater makers just literally got it in like a couple of hours, and they were like, start to come up with ideas, and we could do this, and this. So it's, I think it's a really, really exciting area. And it's, I think to your question, you know, are we changing the way that we look at storytelling? I think what's happening at the moment is that we're laying the groundwork for how you do really effective storytelling in VR, and I think that's where it's really important that you've got theatre practitioners.
Well, it's not just... So the thing about storytelling is there's an element of immersion with storytelling, whether it's a book that creates the virtual reality in your head or the work that you do, Ghislaine, where it's... Well, you've been struggling with this issue of immersion for the last 20 years, is that fair to say? Yeah. Since 1994, I mean... Are you still finding it's the same conversations and the same struggles and the same problems with this technology?
Yes, I think it is. I'm coming from a performing arts background, so I'm linking into a lot of what Toby says, and we've worked together a bit too. From that theatre and performing arts side, we are storytelling, yeah, in many different ways, whether it's a narrative or a much more non-linear scenario, because I'm coming from a dance background, so that actually is a non-linear environment, yeah. And I work with a group called Body Data Space, but previously within a collective called Shinkansen. And since the early 90s, we've been looking at the body as the centre of digital technologies, because a lot of us are coming from performing arts. We were like, all this stuff's happening, but we need to very much hold on to the sense of our natural bodies, ourselves, and also what presence is. So a very big issue in performing arts is this live presence like we've kind of got now, where you can see each other's eyes and connect to each other. So for me and the group I've been working with, and lots of different people across the years, that's been really important. How do we actually get to a point where we can blend between the virtual and physical, but we still actually have built within to that a tele-intuition, a telepresence, which is part of it. So in the 90s, I got very involved in working with telepresence, but with full body, basically full body Skype, between different stages all over the world, linking up people and dancing real time together or doing theatre work real time together. And that focus also in performing arts is very much on group work. You're in a communal or a collective situation. You can do a solo on your own, but in majority, performing arts happens within a group collaborative environment. And so collaboration, connectivity, and presence was really the key to what we were trying to get to in the 90s. And very much the full body as well, and looking at immersion for the full body within data. With body data space, we're working very much with the body and data and virtual and physical space. So we did many, many, many things across the years, but about 4 or 5 years ago, we worked with the National Theatre on a piece called Me and My Shadow, which was a portal piece, which actually had 4 different portals, one in Paris, one in London, one in Istanbul, and one in Brussels. And you could enter it. It was a solo portal, but you entered it and you were immediately real time, a full avatar in a virtual world, and you could meet the others in there. So it would be 4 different people from 4 different countries. We weren't using video feeds, we were using color feeds, framework feeds. So if you were orange, you knew the person in Paris was blue, so you could see that person. And we had very simple instructions, didn't we, to actually just try and meet each other in the middle of the virtual world and try and have some kind of connectivity, kind of hug or an intimacy which was coming into it. And it was a very, very successful project in that lots of people wanted to do it and it didn't crash and everything went really well. But also just the comments that came from it, people were just amazed to be immersed within this world and be able to move around at a distance with people as their full-bodied selves. So people were dancing, people were trying to hug each other. There was a father and mother, a mother and a son that met between Paris and London. There was a real sense of trying to build towards an intimacy or a presence, a virtual presence. So we were getting somewhere there in that kind of collective immersion, connected and collective immersion scenarios with your full body, using your body as it was, and looking towards the pleasure of us being humans as such. So moving on from that and looking and linking up to what's been just said, I think that, you know, we're moving towards many different types of bodies, yeah, ahead. We've got, you know, we are in our natural body forms here, but we know there's many different types of bodies in the world. But we've always felt in our group that we don't need to have attachments. We need to be able to do this in our natural mode, however, whatever our personal natural mode is, yeah? So for me, the headset is a total disembodiment. It actually breaks us away. We could all put them on now, we can be a virtual world together, but we're not actually physically present with each other. So it seems to me the antithesis of the end aim of all this is actually to go into this headset box on your head, which means, you don't move naturally, two, you're not in the same room, physically present, even though you might be working towards a virtual presence. So we've tried to avoid wearables. We've always tried to work with sensors, with Kinect, with telepresence, with motion capture formats, etc. And actually, if we look towards the future, of course, the convergence of those things in relationship to sensors, touch, feel, haptic interfaces, the biofeedback area of heartbeat, breath, etc., coming into that. We're very simple now ways to do this. And working in groups and suddenly heading towards a more interactive haptics situation where you will, and you can see these demos now coming through on the web, where there's, you will actually be working with holograms of each other within the same space, or holograms of 3D objects that you're moving together, etc. So, and I can see this breakthrough happening. It's as if the VR world, like Michael said, is, you know, I've seen this before in robotics too, these things reach a critical point and then they just drop flat. Because actually, and the VR world, the commercial world does realise this too. And again, at Ravensbourne, at the VR UK conference, both of the keynote speakers finished by saying, but we have a problem. We've got to look at virtual presence. We have a problem. What is intimacy in this area? How do we actually stay within a communal environment? Nobody quite knows yet, but we must all work towards that. And I think that's where these more collaborative share spaces are really important, where we can actually experience and extend our experiences and look at hypersensualities, extend our senses and take ourselves further, enhance ourselves in those worlds. And actually, real-time generative is really important in there, but we need to really shift forward on that and enable that. And AR is very important in this, because AR can happen all around our bodies, yeah? So augmented reality is very definitely key, keeping mind on that. Content is the key. Michael said it, Toby's been talking about it, we know. And content is lacking. And we're hearing this now, content is needed, content is king. But we also know that it's still expected to be provided for pretty much free. There's very little status attached to content creation, yeah? And that's very tough, I think, because we will not get more exciting or experiential or extended experiences like you're talking about, Luke. There's new worlds, yeah, occurring before there's money to actually do the content creation side, yeah? Also, we need much more diversity of content. We need a lot more women involved in this scene. It's great to see so many women here now. Actually really wonderful, but we know, I mean, when Oculus Rift was 4 days ago, they did their tweets out about it. The first one shifted, it's been packed, it's left us, you know, to the first person that's bought one. Somebody tweeted me back saying, Ghislaine, you know, out of 120 comments after that tweet, only 2 were from women. And I just thought, right, I'm going to tweet back and say, fine, because we're watching. We're watching and seeing what content needs to come. But that diversity of content, what women can do with content, what different cultures can do with this content, is also very important to come. So I think I'll leave it there for now. I've said about holograms. Yep, keep an eye on what's happening. I'll talk a little bit more later about other bits. Yeah.
So that issue of disembodiment seems to be the key that's stopping us from getting a true immersive experience. And Carl, I want to ask you, how far can we go in, say, using the body and the brain as a platform to overcome the issues that Ghislaine is talking about, which is the feeling of disembodiment when you suddenly put the screen on your face?
Well, much like Carl, I find the disassociated state really fascinating. And as a sort of a counterpoint to what you've just been talking about, I think you can be disassociated.
You're going to have to shout.
Sorry. I think you can be disassociated and completely present at the same time. And I'm really fascinated by sort of overcoming the human condition. And much like we're talking about this idea of replicating experiences that we've already had, I mean, I think we've done content to death. You know, I'm really interested in context. I'm really interested in tweaking my perception in ways that it's never been tweaked before.
What do you mean by context in?
Well, basically this idea that we produce content and we've got a massive resources problem. We've got a planet that's basically, you know, we've used up all the resources producing content, and actually, why don't we actually change the way we perceive that content and context engineer ourselves and the way we perceive, rather than actually make more content?
But Michael, where we are right now, isn't it still a content game? I mean,
yes, absolutely. If we think about content as experiences, you know, so I'm sorry, I'll respectfully disagree with you, Carl, on that. Insofar as I think a lot of, to use sort of a layman's phrase, a lot of the money goes into making the toys, you know, i.e. the technology. But actually, it's what we do with the technology. That's, you know, and for me, that is, you know, maybe it's a difference of semantics. What I'm, or Glenn, is sort of referring to as content. For me, it is about content. It is about, and content, the purpose of content is experience through, to pick up on Toby, through narrative. You know, so that is something that there is quite a dearth of, in my experience. that no, a lot of the money, R&D, you know, it's basically companies developing new technologies, but not alongside people that are often content creators to say, okay, well, here is this wonderful new technology, and let's actually release this with some really provocative content. Good example, let's look at the gaming industry. And I think the gaming industry is a great example because that shows, you know, the upper end of the, you know, it's when the prosumer becomes the mainstream. So let's look at Kinect, for example. Version one of the Kinect. You know, a really exciting piece of technology. But for the mainstream, no one used it because all the games for the original 360 that used Kinect, they were crap. I can tell you, as a gamer with a kid that's like an avid gamer, and you know, all my social circle, we're gamers. You know, people use the first generation of Kinect. What did they use it for? For navigating their Xbox console. That was it, because the great games were terrible. There was nothing that said, I have to buy this. I need this piece of technology, not because who cares about the technology, but because I want this experience. And you get the experience through the content. So no, I disagree. I think the problem is we spend so much of our money on technical R&D in making the device, but we don't actually have the reason to say, okay, I have to have this device because I want this experience. So that's what I think.
Toby, do you get that pushback in the National Theatre? I mean, you have a wealth of content, but is there still an issue of, are we doing this because it's a gimmick, or are we doing it because we want to create and curate new worlds and new experiences?
No, we don't get pushback on that at all. And to go into that point, I think, again, we're at very early doors. There's no reason for me that content and context are mutually exclusive, and that actually you will... the more sophisticated experiences will be the ones that blend the two together. So actually in the piece that we made for Wonderland, we've got an installation front of house at the National Theatre. And in the show, she quite often, when she's in school, goes into the school toilets to go on her phone. That's the context of how she goes into Wonderland. So what we did at the NT is that we recreated the school toilets with kind of all the toilets, graffiti, the whole thing. And to actually use the Oculus Rift, you have to sit on the toilet. So we've got this wall of six toilets. And that physical context, it's not some of the kind of really kind of sophisticated context, like kind of biometrics, that kind of stuff. But that made a huge difference. And there's actually three things happening there. You've got the virtual world, you've got the physical realization of something, and you've got the context working as well. And those three things made it a hell of a lot more compelling for audiences. We could have just done it purely technical, like with Rift headsets and nothing else, and that would have worked. But actually having context and a kind of physical base to it as well has really, really helped. But in answer to our question, no, we're not doing this as a gimmick. We don't get any pushback at all. Everybody that I've shown it to has just, like all the writers and directors that I've shown it to, everyone starts off with questions. It's less about, is this a gimmick? It's like, why is the NT making what they see as films? And then it's always slightly kind of questioning, and I'm just like, can I just put a headset on you and try it? Not saying headset's the end goal, it's not. But once they try it, they're just like, shit, totally get it now. And then there's like almost like a 5-minute come down where they're like, the minds are just like trying to think of all the things they can do with these things, and just, it's almost like quite cathartic. So. Yeah, there's no pushback on content. I don't think headsets are the end goal, definitely not for us. But the thing for us is that it's difficult is the shared experience, the live shared experience is a massive part of what we do. So the idea that you invite a group of people in and then they all put headsets in and exclude themselves from each other is against a big part of what we do. But we know that, like, I call this whole area immersive storytelling. Like, there's no reason that you should be able to answer the questions now, but you've got to practice in the area for a period of time. We'll know in 12 months' time what the best way to deliver a blended live and VR experience is. And that'll be a combination of both our own learnings and learnings of everyone else, but also the advancement of tech by that point as well. You know, some of the things that we're talking about now, you'll look back in 5 years' time and be like, God, can't believe we were so bored by those issues, do you know what I mean? Because they are just current technical issues rather than concepts of what we're actually working on.
Can I just come back on that quickly?
Go ahead.
Yeah, just my point is this idea that, you know, we talk about content and we talk about context. I suppose I'm really interested in a lot of people taking psychedelics, for instance, to create a very much a contextual experience. They're sitting with their own perception. So people having lucid dreams, people having out-of-body experiences, me wearing a 360 helmet for a week meant that I had a very different reality to what I normally have. And I'm really interested in how do we quantify that? How do we create tools that allow those kinds of experiences? And that's what I mean by working on context rather than content.
And we're going to have a second panel later, a shorter panel, a half an hour panel, specifically looking at how you take the psychonautic experience and then plug that directly into VR. But Ghislaine, without the psychonautic experience, again, how do we deal with this issue of immersion? How do you bring bodies into space in the way in which Toby is saying? How do we have that collective experience? Do we negate the technology, or how do we embrace it in a way in which we can have?
I think we've got to keep our visions completely open, and I think, you know, Toby's completely right. We've got to go through the various bits of tech as they come up, and at the moment we're in helmet land, yeah, and we will be for a while longer. You can see them coming out; they're just mad. I mean, there's literally an announcement every single day, and the content side of that needs to be more non-linear. I'm completely with Carl, actually, on taking the user experience into that. But what we know already from interactive art is that there's always authors who set the boundaries, and then you go in and you do what you want within it. But the boundaries are there. The authors have to let go. We've been in many projects like that. Michael's done one with us, which was you had to let go to probably 200 other people actually yep. took over the making of it, but Michael is setting the parameters and leading it through. The users then make their own routes through that, and that's where we start to get interesting and that complex for theatre work, although Punch Drunk are a good example of that, and so are many others, where in physical theatre terms, already you go in and you experience and you take a route through, which is pretty much led, but it's not led, and you're getting an experience. We go way ahead and we look beyond the headset. We need to look at implants. We need to look at actually what goes inside our bodies and how that is coming into many areas, the workplace area, health and well-being areas, etc. And what we will control from our bodies without add-ons to our bodies. We need to actually go, well, do I need this big watch here? You know, no, I don't actually. That could be a very simple implant here and another one here, and I can do the same things with it. And that's why I think augmented reality is very important too, because that can come up around us. And that can come up around us in this room now, and we could all be experiencing it at this point. They can be tethered, they can be GPS, we can put content in, we can see adverts, of course, that's what we're going to get first, is all the AR advert stuff is what's being pushed, yeah? I mean, I think Blipbar just got 54 million put into them. It's going to go. AR is going to go in the advertising world totally. But implants and AR, holograms, keep a real close eye on holograms and on real-time. Real-time generative, where what you're moving through, whether you're in a headset, or whether you're doing it with your implants or whatever, actually is changing, linked to a variety of choices that you make. So we're back there to Carl's thinking about actually the journey you want and what you're wanting from that experience on that day, which might be a soft, sweet, lucid dream, or you might be ready for a full-on weekend experience, yeah, and you're going to go for it. But that content may be held within one place, but you have many, many different routes through it. So it's user-led in the end. And somehow, I feel we're going towards that. But we're probably still 10 years off that, but we need, like Toby says, to start making now and testing and putting people into these user experiences and getting feedback, etc., so that actually the user, like Michael says, is at the beginning of the experience, yeah. Not... you know, when they put the headsets out, put them on people's heads, and then chuck some content in it, which is all rather dull, yeah?
So we have, we're going to, so for the next half an hour, we've got a whole bunch of experiences, which I hope are not rather dull, in the basement.
Sure,
and then we're going to, anybody who's got the Google Cardboards, I think we still have a couple available, but we're going to all come up here together at about 8:40 to have a collective VR experience to Timothy Leary's One Brain, which is a world premiere of a music piece prepared by Simon Boswell, and that Hack the Planet, you're going to have to download the app beforehand, is an app that's being created by Psych-Fi. But I do, because I feel like knowing some of the people who are in this room, we could have had a whole conference on VR. I do want to at least get one question from the audience make it a really, really good one. We will judge you if it's bad. Oh, wow. That was that's the best way to shut down an audience.
Will 2016 be the year of the VR selfie or something?
So will 2016 be the year of the VR selfie?
I think so. I think there's quite a lot of group VR selfies out there. There was the Mark Zuckerberg one, wasn't there, from the Barcelona Mobile Congress. I was at Canada House recently for a VR event. We all had to put on these Google cardboards and all have the photo taken. So I think you're right, yeah. So
before I do a little more logistics, because I realize everybody, one, wants to go to the bar to diminish their reality, two, go outside for a smoke, three, experience the VR, and four, come back to experience the collective Hack the Planet experience at 8:40. But I want to end with this. The future is always virtual, and anything that may seem imminent or inevitable sometimes never actually happens. Fortunately, our ability to survive the future is not predicated on our capacity for prediction. Though, sometimes on those much more rare occasions, something remarkable comes of staring the future deep in the eyes and challenging everything that it seems to promise. I hope you feel you've done that in that panel. Join us at 8:40 up here for the collective VR experience. The bar is open, and please go explore the basement.